This isn't just a newspaper story, Hildy. It's a career. And you stand there belly aching about whether you catch an 8 o'clock train or a 9 o'clock train.
Walter, I never figured it that
way. Oh, you're still a doll-faced hick, that's why.
Gee, we'd be the white-haired boys.
Sure, there'll be naming streets after you. Hildy Johnson Street. There'll be statues of you in the park. The movies will be after you. The radio. By tomorrow morning, I'll bet you there's a Hildy Johnson cigar. You see the billboards now? It says, light up with Hildy Johnson.
Oh, Walter, would you stop that acting?
Huh?
We got a lot to do.
Now you're talking.
This isn't your orthodox appreciation, though I'm hoping it will illuminate aspects of the film for you. My main purpose is simply to talk about a film that I've loved for over 40 years, and I hope to show you why it's become important to the way I and some other people think about studying the history of film. Like a lot of young cinephiles, I was introduced to director Howard Hawks in print, not on the screen. I learned of him from Andrew Saras, writing in his 1963 issue of Film Culture, devoted to American directors. By then, Saras could refer to Hawks as a recognized major director. Saras didn't dwell on the fact that that recognition had its origins in France, not America. It began in the 1930s, when Parisian critics praised Hawks' 1928 silent comedy, A Girl in Every Port, and his 1932 gangster film, Scarface. Then, after World War II, Henri Langlois launched his Cinémathèque. He programmed Hawks films and introduced a new generation to them. Most prominent among that new generation was a cadre of critics at Cahiers du Cinéma. In their magazine, they promoted the idea that the best films came from auteurs, cinematic authors, directors who expressed themselves as fully in film as novelists or painters did in their art forms. As a result, the Cahiers critics proclaimed that Hawks and Hitchcock, along with many other Hollywood craftsmen, were auteurs, deserving praise and critical attention. Young Americans took notice, not only Saras, but also Peter Bogdanovich, who mounted a big Hawks retrospective at New York's Museum of Modern Art. In 1968, Hawks was accorded a full-length study in English by the British critic Robin Wood, and this book remains a cornerstone of critical work on the director. In all this critical activity, a directorial personality emerged. While Hitchcock specialized in thrillers, Hawks mastered many genres, from comedy and adventure to westerns and musicals. No matter what genre, Hawks films had a personal touch. Like any auteur worthy of notice, he had his recurring thematic concerns: the values of professionalism, a stoic acceptance of duty, and the sense that both men and women can measure up to high standards of responsibility. In his world, the highest mark of personal conduct was to be good, that is, excellent, at your job and at managing your way in the world. Technically, critics praised Hawks' simplicity. If Hitchcock was the flagrant stylist, he was the master of unobtrusive artistry. He avoided fancy camera angles and tricky camera movements and arty lighting designs. The emphasis fell on the stories he had to tell, carried by performers who played their parts with brisk efficiency and relaxed energy.
He's not the man for you, I can see that, but I sort of like him. He's got a lot of charm.
Well, it comes about naturally. His grandfather was a snake.
If Hawks had a personal style, critics suggested, it lay in his skill in directing actors. He worked slowly, maddening producers by going over schedule and budget. The extra time was consumed rewriting the script on the set and building up performances there. Hawks had begun in cinema as a writer of titles for silent pictures, and he placed enormous emphasis on language. He encouraged his cast to improvise their lines. He asked even crew members to suggest what the character might say. Hawks livened up those performances considerably. He gave his actors a suite of gestures, stances, and highly characterized walks. He let actors jam their hands in their pockets and twist their bodies to talk in each other's faces. He gave them byplay with props, too. George Raft developed his coin-flipping signature in Scarface. Hawks also prided himself on developing overlapping dialogue. To pick up the pace, he made the actors interrupt each other and step on each other's lines. When asked if that wasn't artificial, he responded, "Listening on a cocktail party sometime." The overlapping dialogue wouldn't be so effective if it weren't also incredibly fast. Hawks believed that the very first talkies, with their emphasis on theatrical line delivery, had dragged down filmic pacing. They also diverged from the brisk way people talked in real life. So he experimented with natural, frantically fast line delivery in earlier films like 20th Century and Ceiling Zero of 1936.
That's a broad statement.
Yours is a 220 against 160 for your job.
Who says so? I did. Lands at 55 with the wing flaps down.
That's impossible.
It is. Took off with one motor and a full load. Can the Adams bomber do that?
With His Girl Friday, Hawks stepped on the accelerator. Publicity for the film claimed that it included speeches running 240 words per minute. Actually, my colleague, the historian Leah Jacobs, has found that some portions run over 300 words a minute. That's twice the rate of normal conversation.
What are you doing?
Who is she?
This is Mrs. Baldwin, Bruce's mother.
What are you doing?
Shut up.
I won't shut up. You're doing something wrong.
Mother, please.
Take her out of here.
What? Now, wait a minute, Walter.
Quiet, Louis.
Yes, boss.
Take the lady over to Polog Mike's.
What? My name's Louis Peluso.
Lock her up. See if she doesn't talk to anyone.
You can't do this.
What'll I tell him?
Tell him it's a case of DT.
Don't worry, Mother. This is only temporary.
Leah attributes the breakneck speed of the film to other factors as well. Hawks gives us simultaneous conversations. He eliminates pauses. He slips in interjections from listening characters. And he contrasts fast-talking characters with slower ones. We can see several of these factors at work in this short scene. Starts slowly and builds to a fever pitch with interruptions and overlaps before slowing down and moving to silence.
Come on, Hilly, you're coming with me right now.
Please give me just a second, can't you? Don't you see this is the biggest thing in my life?
Keep quiet, Hilly.
I see. I'll keep. I'm like something in the icebox, aren't I?
Yeah.
You just don't love me.
Oh, now that isn't true. Just because you won't listen, you say I don't love you. Now you know that isn't the point at all.
What else have you done?
The point is that you never intended to be decent and live like a human being.
What's that?
All right, all right. If that's
the
way you want
to think. Oh, Sebastian jumping. I'm trying to concentrate.
You're just like him and all the rest.
Sure, sure. That's what I am.
What? What? No, no. Leave the rooster story alone. That's human interest.
All these creative choices about dialogue make Hawks' sound style as distinctive as any signature visual techniques would be. Despite its original treatment of dialogue, His Girl Friday didn't play a big role in either the French or the American revival of Hawks' reputation. Critics focused on his most recent films like Monkey Business of 1952 and Rio Bravo of 1959. It wasn't until the early 1970s that His Girl Friday gained wide notice, and that owed something to an accident. In those days, before video, 16 millimeter was the common format for collecting movies and screening them on college campuses. Through an oversight, Columbia Pictures failed to renew His Girl Friday's copyright. As a result, a great many 16 millimeter film dealers began selling prints as public domain items. Many were quite poor dupes. And just at this moment, universities began teaching courses in film history and appreciation. So His Girl Friday was an easy acquisition on the collector's market. This is what happened when I came out of grad school, where I'd seen the film in the early 70s. His Girl Friday was the first film I bought for our department at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. And because our budget was tight, I used it over and over to teach critical analysis, comedy as a genre, and Hawks as auteur. By analyzing individual films, you could arrive at some overall ideas about how Hollywood studio films told their stories. This impulse led me to look into the principles of what people were calling classical Hollywood cinema. The term had already come up among the first wave of Hawksians. In the 50s and 60s, Bogdanovich called him, quote, probably the most typical American director of all, end quote. Richard Griffith, curator of MoMA, said that, quote, Hawks works cleanly and simply in the classical American cinematic tradition, without appliqued aesthetic curlicues, end quote. But what is that tradition? For the earliest Hawks enthusiasts, it came down, I think, to bold, vigorous, efficient storytelling that carried an emotional impact. On those dimensions, Hawks clearly scored high. But I thought we could get more specific. In my research, I was interested in specifying the artistic norms and variations possible within this classical system. What principles of plot construction did filmmakers favor? What were their preferred stylistic strategies of staging, framing, cutting, or sound? How did classical movie makers treat causality and time and space? In starting to answer these questions, I found a rich data set right in front of me, our increasingly haggard 16 millimeter print of His Girl Friday. Let's go back to Hawks' contribution to sound cinema. I began to wonder about how His Girl Friday fitted into Hollywood's tradition of comedy. It's a comedy tailored to modern tastes. It's anti-sentimental and sometimes cruel. After flattering Louis, for example, Walter tells Hildy,
"That dumb immigrant to flop on me as sure as you're born."
It spares little pity for the losers, Earl Williams, Molly Malloy, and Bruce Baldwin and his mother, the closest we have to ordinary citizens. When Molly jumps out the window, what could have been a moment of intense pathos is undercut by Walter Burns walking in immediately, a surefire laugh getter.
It'll be true. You'll never find him now.
Oh.
Kill the ambulance, somebody.
Yet the film has a romantic and idealistic streak, too. Hildy and Walter deserve each other, two professionals who can't accept life among the squares. And the film treats the newspaper game as the last frontier of adventure in the modern city. The newspaper genre, jammed with hustlers always ready with a quip or a lie, presented a world driven by deadlines, scoops, and flinty knowledge of the worst of human nature.
Well, that's kind of raw, Roy. After all, I can't hang a man in his sleep just to please a newspaper.
Nope. His Girl Friday's parade of official clowns, Sheriff Hartwell, the mayor, even Pettibone, the deus ex machina, only shows the superior wit and cunning of Walter and Hildy. Yet blessed by that unseen power that watches over the Morning Post, our couple becomes somewhat heroic.
Arrest him.
Just a minute. Trying to hang an innocent man to win an election, eh?
That's murder.
That's a lie.
Never saw him before.
Well, if I was to tell my wife...
What's your name?
Pettibone. Joe Pettibone.
When did you deliver this first, Mr. Pettibone?
Who'd you talk to?
They started right in bribing me.
Who's they?
Those. Them.
That's absurd on the face of it. Walnery's talking like a child.
Yeah, out of the mouths of babes.
Hi, babe.
The tough tone comes from the film's source, the stage comedy The Front Page of 1928. It was famous for its quick pace, its foul language, and its hilariously brutal view of human nature. The titanic effort of editor Walter Burns to retain Hildy Johnson, the prized newsman who wants to quit and marry a conventional woman, was a perfectly engineered entertainment. Drama critic Walter Kerr called this mechanical stage marvel a watch that laughs. The play became a part of theater history, and in the days before the Hays Code took effect, the first film version was seen as no less audacious. It too played fast and hard, and it even managed to retain the play's famous closing line.
The son of a stole my watch.
The speed and punch of the play became a general model for Hollywood. In the 1970s, I asked the great producer Dory Sherry what films most influenced studio writers and directors in the 30s. Not a film, he told me, a play, The Front Page. Out of Ben Hecht and Charles MacArthur's stage success came a template for the rapid-fire comedies and gangster movies and backstage musicals of that era. It was a model suited to sound filming. At the same period, the studios developed what was called the switch or the switcheroo. Vincent Sherman explained that involved screenwriters taking stories from movies that have been made before, changing the background and a few details, and presenting them as new. For example, Warners redid the Betty Davis vehicle, The Letter, as The Unfaithful. Often the switch involved a gender change. At Warner's, Dr. Socrates became king of the underworld by putting Kay Francis in Paul Muni's role. Given Hollywood's reliance on the switch, it's not surprising that His Girl Friday got a makeover. According to Hawks, at a party, he claimed that the play had the finest dialogue on the modern stage. When some partygoers started reading it aloud, he realized that things went better when a woman read Hildy's part.
Double-crossing hyena,
what's
I'd like to take
matter, him. Hildy?
Don't give me that innocent stuff. What did you pull on Mr. Baldwin this time?
Who, me?
Yes, you and that albino of yours.
You talking about Evangeline?
None other.
She ain't no albino.
She'll do till one comes
she
along.
She was born right here in this country.
If she tries anything else, you'll have to stay right here in this country.
Mind.
And you too, and it won't be on a phony charge either. Did you bring that money?
Oh, yeah. $400.
$450.
All right. You can't blame a guy for trying. Yeah, you better give me a receipt.
Well, I'll give you a scar.
I got plenty of them.
Oh, and I'll take Mr. Baldwin's wallet, too.
His Girl Friday became the most famous switcheroo of the period, what we might today call a reinvention of the original stage play.
Oh, now the moon's out.
Fine, three taps is made, don't forget. How are you doing? Got enough air?
Not very much.
That better? You're sitting pretty. How's it coming, honey?
Oh. If we take His Girl Friday as not only a Hawks film, but rather a typical Hollywood film, what can it teach us about so-called classical filmmaking? A lot, I found. Most generally, it teaches us how a gifted director uses classical techniques in powerful and original ways. Consider the film's narrative. It centers on characters with sharply defined goals. Hildy wants, or thinks she wants, a stable and ordinary married life. But her ex-husband, Walter, wants her to come back to work for his newspaper. The city officials want to execute Earl Williams, while Walter wants to stop the execution. Not because of regard for Williams, but out of an urge to attack the political machine just before the election. The result of these conflicting goals is two lines of action that become connected. To win back Hildy, Walter induces her to write a story that will swing sympathy to Williams. In the meantime, the governor has reprieved Williams, but the mayor and the sheriff send away the courier, Pettibone, so they can go ahead with the hanging. This double-braided plot, I realized, is characteristic of studio filmmaking of the period and of our movies today. Most classical Hollywood films have two storylines, with one usually about romantic love. The other, as in His Girl Friday, often involves work. And as in His Girl Friday, the two lines of action aren't totally separate. They depend on one another. His Girl Friday is driven by deadlines, as many newspaper movies are, but here they cascade the deadline for copy, but also for the trains that Walter and Hildy will take, and the scheduled hanging of Earl Williams. But if we go beyond the newspaper genre, we find that Hollywood films as a whole rely on deadlines, particularly in their final stretches. Think of recent movies like The Hangover, where the need to find the groom and get him to the wedding on time structures the whole plot. Again, His Girl Friday exemplifies a general principle of classical movie engineering. At a still more granular level, there are hooks between scenes. Walter says he'll take Hildy and Bruce to lunch, dissolved to them entering a restaurant. At the restaurant, two plans are formulated. Hildy will write the story only if Walter will buy an insurance policy. The next two scenes deal with each of these plans in order. Simple as they seem, these dangling causes at the end of scenes create a strong continuity leading to future scenes. All these factors give the classical film a forward momentum, pushing the viewer to wonder what can happen next. One more classical feature in Hawks' film struck me, the shrewd use of visual and dramatic motifs. Hollywood films love lines of dialogue that recur. Here's looking at you, kid. You complete me. And objects that reappear with new implications, the rosebud sled being the most famous. The most interesting motif in His Girl Friday seems to me the telephone. Of course, reporters naturally use telephones to call their editors and to contact sources. But in this film, the phone becomes a comic motif. It starts simply enough with Walter using phones to fool Hildy. First, pretending that his top reporter can't cover the story.
Listen, sweetie, you can't do that to me. Not today of all days.
What's the matter with you? Are you loony?
Jumping Jehoshaphat.
Then having himself called to the phone in order to launch his big scheme.
Call me to the telephone as soon as I get back to the table.
Sure. Thanks, guys. That's fine. Hey, it's on.
But afterward, we get phone conversations during other conversations. We get characters talking on two phones at once. McHugh early on, later Hildy to Walter and to Bruce. Most elaborately, there are phone fugues when several reporters chime in to report the latest twist in the action.
Just when they opened the desk.
Williams put up a desperate struggle, but the police overpowered him.
He offered no resistance.
He tried to shoot out with the cops, but his gun wouldn't work.
He break through a whole cordon of police.
Duffy, the morning post
just
turned Williams over to the sheriff.
As usual, the phone scenes enhance the thrusting tempo of the movie as a whole. In retrospect, we can see one moment as announcing the motif. After Hildy tells Walter she's getting married, he's momentarily stunned into silence. He turns from her, pondering, and he begins tapping on his phone, as if plotting how to use it to block her wedding. The rest of the movie will show how the phone helps him intimidate everyone around him. Here, he even treats his phone as a sort of talisman or good luck piece to be consulted in a crisis. This guy thinks with his phone. Classical cinema is about more than plot. It uses cinema technique for its storytelling ends. The technique that scholars have most studied is editing, and here too, His Girl Friday has a lot to teach us. Hawks' famous unobtrusive technique points directly to one function of cutting in Hollywood films. In most cases, it's designed to be unnoticed. The hallmark of classical editing is invisibility. Cutting is used to serve the unfolding story. As a result, Hollywood developed in the 1910s a system called continuity editing that maximizes the flow of the action. His Girl Friday can be studied for its careful use of analytical editing, breaking up a long shot into closer views, and its reliance on shot, reverse shot for dialogue. But it avoids very flashy cutting, except in two spots. Both, as you'd expect, involve phones. The first comes when the reporters learn of Earl's escape, and a burst of shots shows each one hollering the news into his phone. The second montage is devoted to a similar situation when the reporters watch the police surround the desk in which Earl Williams is hiding.
We got you covered, Williams.
Have it in a minute.
Don't try to move.
Any time now.
I'll count three.
It's hot.
One.
Ready for an emergency.
Two.
Any second now.
Three. Up with it. I got you, Williams.
Go ahead, shoot me.
In both cases, Hawks' editing has comically exaggerated their sensationalistic lust for a scoop. For the most part, though, the cutting is at the service of the staging and performance. Yet, a director can still be creative in this process. For example, the director can try to match on the actor's actions. When Hildy flings her purse at Walter in the opening scene, he ducks. Her action is pretty smoothly matched across the cut, and this accentuates her gesture. True, Walter's arm positions here change a bit from shot to shot, but Hawk seems to have assumed that we're concentrating on her, not him. More generally, Hawks' love of improvisation on the set comes with a cost. Two shots filmed in different takes, perhaps days apart, will be difficult to match when there are several actors in motion. Again, Hawks works to speed up the film through cutting. In the climax, Walter seems to take charge of the acceleration. In one shot, he enters from a point much closer to the other characters than the one he occupied in the previous shot. And when Pettibone and the city officials leave, Walter can be heard chortling with Hildy off-screen before we see them in the next shot. A little bit of time is skipped over. This cut gets the other characters out of the scene even faster. There's a striking moment when Hawks stretches out time through editing. Hildy enters the press room after the reporters have humiliated Molly, and Hawks cuts into a closer view. The door swings open twice, creating a pronounced overlap, serving to stress Hildy's arrival and her stern disapproval of her colleagues, gentlemen of the press. What about Hollywood staging? Here again, his girl Friday can tutor us. From the early silent cinema to the present, one of the director's primary jobs is to move people around the frame in patterns that are attractive and that call our attention to the most important story points at just the right moment. The director, in other words, doesn't just direct actors. The director directs our attention. To direct our attention, studio directors of the 1930s, 1940s favored staging over camera movement. Today's directors move the camera more, but the classical filmmakers move the actors. Given Hawks' famous neutrality and invisible style, he ought to offer some good examples, and indeed he does. He moves his actors around the set quite a lot, letting the camera reframe them in a relaxed but emphatic way. The scene in Walter's office is a tour de force of careful reframing that adjusts to the two actors' shifting positions and postures. Very often, Hawks stages his scenes in depth with figures at different planes. Later in the 1940s, Orson Welles would become famous for depth staging and deep focus cinematography, but other filmmakers were pushing in that direction earlier, and Hawks was one. Other scenes with the reporters in the courtroom press office display ingenious patterns of men shifting and rearranging themselves in different areas of the shot, here when they're chastened by Hildy's disapproval. Often the background involves the antics of McHugh peering up the staircase as women walk past. These unassertive, relaxed uses of depth contrast with the aggressive, big foreground style of Citizen Kane. Probably the boldest instance of depth staging comes in the framing of the window from outside. Through it, we can see characters in the distance entering the press room. The first instance is innocuous, but the second highlights Walter's entry. Most subtle of all is Hawks' choreography of characters moving to empty and fill areas of the shot. When Molly enters to chastise the reporters, she occupies the favored spot above them. But as she moves, Hildy is close behind, and she commands our attention. The camera arcs slightly to keep their interactions balanced. At another point, we can see gaps opened up and filled during an intense dialogue scene. The reporters gradually crowd around Molly, trapping her, not so much by their proximity to her as by their filling up of the frame space. And at the climax, when Molly runs to the window, her approach is momentarily blocked, but the reporters in the foreground gracefully lunge aside to reveal very clearly the moment when she leaps out. This is skillful direction of a sort that almost no filmmakers today could replicate. Hawks' vaunted simplicity, then, turns out to depend upon some rich, complicated creative choices. He practices without fuss a refined craft that came with the job. Like his characters, Hawks displayed a relaxed, precise professionalism.
The voice doesn't mean anything nowadays, Hildy. Just a few words mumbled over you by a judge.
Across several decades, my interest in individual film artistry has been matched by my curiosity about the Hollywood tradition. Other films in His Girl Friday, Meet Me in St. Louis, How Green Was My Valley, Shadow of a Doubt, have guided me to deeper understanding of both. But this movie has a special place for me. Hawks is, of course, an excellent director, and he repays auteur study, as well as a study of how he relates to the classical Hollywood tradition. But every time I see the film, after 45 years of studying it and rewatching it, I still find it immensely entertaining. Every time I see it, I still laugh my ass off.